Hi, welcome to the Bridge Connection. Here we are on Friday again. It seemed like a couple days ago it was Friday again. Time is moving so fast for me. I don't know if it's my age or if it's the age in which we live, but it just seems like the weeks are just flying by. Not that I'm accomplishing much, but all of a sudden I turn around and it's the end of the week again. And so hope you're enjoying these times together. We've been doing this almost since the pandemic started. Right now we decided to go through the book of Psalms. It's been a long time since I've just done a chapter by chapter through the book of Psalms. And I hope you're enjoying it as much as I am. David has such insight on God's working in his life and who God is and what was required of David himself and what's required of us. And we talked about the first half of the 18th Psalm yesterday. We're going to pick it up at verse 25 today. And David is using this Psalm just to talk about the goodness of God because he's been there and will continue to be there. So let's pick it up. Verse 25. It says, "With the merciful, you will show yourself merciful. With a blameless man, you will show yourself blameless." Verse 26. "With the pure, you will show yourself pure. And with the devious, you will show yourself shrewd. For you will save the humble people." Verse 27. "But will bring down haughty looks." God rewards people according to their lives, according to our character. You know, to those who are faithful, he in turn is faithful to us. God shows himself to be blameless and pure to those who are attempting to walk in the life of God, blameless and pure, and doing the best that we can. But those who are crooked, those who are haughty or devious or any of those things, those who are crooked, God shows himself to be really shrewd, and I think that kind of means that, he will judge them in pretty harsh ways. If anybody insists on pursuing devious ways, God will reward them accordingly, giving them what they deserve. According to David, the Lord exalts the humble, but will bring low the haughty, those prideful, those who think that they can do it themselves. They think that they have it all together, that they have all the answers and they don't need God. And humble yourself the sight of the Almighty God, and he will lift you up. And here's a pretty good bit of advice. If we don't humble ourselves, he'll do it for us. And I'm telling you, when he humbles us, it's tough. It's hard. So I would say we need to humble ourselves and not think more highly than we ought to. You know, because we are really sinners saved by grace. Except the grace of God, there go I. You know, in me dwells no good thing except the Spirit of God himself. And we need to understand that. And that's what God looks at. He realizes that we know that without him, we can do absolutely nothing. And we've tried. We all have. We've tried to accomplish it on our own. We've tried to make it happen on our own. We've tried to do these things. And every time we do, we stumble and fall down so hard. And it's tough. Pick it up at verse 28. I'm going to read a bit, so just follow me in your Bibles, all right? Verse 28, "For you will light my lamp, the Lord my God will enlighten my darkness. For by you I can run against a troop. For my God, I can leap, by my God, I can leap over a wall. As for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is proven. He's a shield to all who trust in him." I want to trust in him, so he's a shield for my life. "For who is God except the Lord? And who is a rock except our God? It is God who arms me with strength and makes my way perfect. He makes my feet like the feet of deer, who sets me on high places. He teaches my hands to make war so that my arms can bend a bow of bronze. You also have given me the shield of your salvation. Your right hand has held me up. Your gentleness has made me great. You enlarge my path under me, so my feet did not slip. I know I read a lot there, but I've got a lot to say about that too. I wanted to kind of put it together. David claimed here that God caused his life to flourish by his favor. He claimed that the Lord would keep his light going. He would enlighten his life. He would keep his lamp burning. God would cause his life to expand, to be blessed. With the Lord's help, he could advance and overtake the opposition. In fact, with God's help, he said he could even scale a wall in battle. I know it said jump a wall, but I've got to believe it was scale a wall, because at my age, I don't even know if I have energy to walk around the wall. But he could scale a wall in battle, because God was and is his shield. God was and is his rock. And because of that, the Lord enabled David to stand with strength on the mountaintops. He was able to stand there victorious. David could fight triumphantly. David could win because he was such a grandioso, strong soldier, but it was because God empowered him supernaturally to bend a bow of bronze. He said, he has given me the strength to bend the bow. And we'll realize, no matter what we do, no matter what talents we have, no matter what good things we accomplish, no matter what we think we're able to do, we need to understand God gives us the strength to do that. God gives us the talent to pull the bow. God gives us the talent to sing, to lead worship. God gives us the talent to take care of children and meet their needs and love them in the name of Jesus. You know, God gives us the ability to teach his word and understand his word, and it goes on and on and on. And what David is saying is that God and nobody else, it was just God who allowed him to make him great before his enemies. It wasn't because he was a great man. It wasn't because he had it all together. It wasn't that he was so powerful. It was because God made him great before his enemies. The Lord made David's footing on the path, so made it solid as he walked and as he did the things that God called him to do, so David would not fall. And think about this, man. Has God given you purpose? Of course he has. Has God given you vision? If he hasn't, you're not listening. He wants to lead me on his word maybe enough, or you're not praying. I don't know, but he without a vision, we perish. And that vision is just, God, what do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? What do you want me to say? How do you want to use me today, every day? Maybe I don't have a vision for the next 20 years. Maybe I have a vision for the next 10 minutes because God's told me to go take care of this situation. And I want to be everything that God wants me to be. And so that I will not fall. When he puts me in a situation that's beyond me, when he puts me in a situation that I can't handle, when he puts me in a situation that I know in my flesh, I just can't do this. And there are many things. And the older I get, the less confident I have become. And that's the truth. When I was younger, I guess I could rely upon my strength a lot or whatever, my youth a lot. But as I get older and things come up and I have to take care of a situation, or God's called me to go take care of this thing or to minister in this area or to meet these people. And sometimes, and it happens as it's happening more often than not anymore, I go in fear and trembling. And I don't mean I'm shaking in my boots, but I'm going knowing that if I do not rely upon God in this situation, I will fail. If I walk into this situation thinking, I have the words, I have the answers, I've counseled this before, it's counseling session number 23A, paragraph 6, and this is the answer. If I go with that attitude, I'm going to fail miserably. And that's true for you too. No matter what God's calling you to do, no matter what he lays before you, no matter what God has for you in this life, if you try to do it without him, you may even look successful, but it will not have eternal results. Only what's done with him, under his power, under his direction, will last for eternity. And, I don't want my stuff, to be wood, hay, and stubble. So when it comes before that time of the judgment seat of Christ, and I don't want everything to burn up because I did it for self-gratification, or I did it because I would look good, or I did it because I think I could handle it. It's only those things we have done, motivated by love for him and for others, and we're being empowered by him so that needs can be met, and he will receive the praise and the glory for everything we do, my friends. And it's a constant battle. It's a constant battle that we're all in. Pick up verse 37. I have pursued my enemies and overtaken them. Neither did I turn back again till they were destroyed. I have wounded them so that they could not rise. They have fallen under my feet. For you have armed me with strength for the battle. You have subdued under me those who rose up against me. You have also given me the necks of my enemies so that I destroyed those who hated me. They cried out, but there was none to save. Even the Lord, he did not answer them. Then I beat them as fine as the dust before the wind. I cast them out like dirt in the streets. So David was empowered by supernatural strength. Strength directly from God. And there are those times, have you had those times in your life where you just get through accomplishing something and you go, wow, God did that. That was totally a God thing. That was God showing off doing something that I couldn't do. I thought I could do this and I thought I was doing well, but now that I look at it and think about it, it had nothing to do with me. That was totally a God thing. Empowered me. He gave me words at times that I teach even now more often than before, that many times I'll say something that I don't remember studying. I don't remember, and I'll hear it and I'll say, wow, Lord, thank you. Maybe that's just for me, or I'm supposed to speak that now, but it's just a word that makes sense and I hadn't even thought of it before. And you know that it's God's supernatural power. You're in a situation, all of a sudden you have an answer to that situation you never thought of before. All of a sudden, maybe you're in a group, you guys are praying, a group of people are praying for a situation, and all of a sudden somebody comes up with, why don't we try that? Maybe God is, and pretty soon you realize that God has taken care of the thing. I want to be able to leave my prayer times with people. I want to be able to leave my times with leaders in the church, and I want to be able to walk away and say, as the early disciples said, it seemed good to us and to the Holy Spirit. I want to make sure that it seemed good to me, but it seemed good to God, and I know it was him doing it. And those times are so precious. Maybe you had a conversation with somebody, and all of a sudden you said something, and they go, what? What did you say? And you go, I don't know. I wasn't listening. And so they repeat it for you, and you go, wow. And they say, thank you. How'd you know? How did I know what? How'd you know what I'm going through? That's the answer to what I've been struggling with for a long time now. Thank you. And all of a sudden you realize you had nothing to do with it, but God used you. Well, I guess you had something to do with it because God used you, and he used you because he knew that you were in the place that you could be used. So yeah, we have to be in the right place for God to use us. So it does have some things to do with us. Clearly it was God, David testified, who armed him with strength to utterly beat these men. Every time David was victorious, David is saying that his winning was due to God's empowering him. Oh, dear Lord, Let us be so quick to always give you the glory and not try to take it for ourselves. Verse 43, you have delivered me from the strivings of the people. You have made me the head of nations. A people I have not known shall serve me. As soon as they hear of me, they will obey me. The foreigners submit to me. The foreigners fade away and come frightened from their hideouts. Having routed his enemies, David was elevated by God to rule over them. So David said, you've somehow made me the head of nations, of people that I was afraid of and that were ruling me and troubling me, man. A position of military and even political superiority. These once enemies of David, they were now subject to him and because God had given him the victory. And that victory was so complete that they cringed before David and they lost heart. Pick up verse 46 to the end of the chapter. The Lord lives. Blessed be my rock. Let the God of my salvation be exalted. It is God who avenges me and subdues the people under me. He delivers me from my enemies. You also lift me up above those who rise against me. You have delivered me from the violent man. Therefore, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the Gentiles, and sing praises to your name. Verse 50, a great deliverance he gives to his king and shows mercy to his anointed, to David and his descendants forever, evermore. With an outburst in the finality of everything here, an outburst of praise. David raised his voice to declare, and I love that, the Lord wins. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock. He's our rock, ladies and gentlemen. Is he your rock today? God subdued David's enemies who were violent men. And David concluded by saying, I will sing praises to your name. So complete were these victories that they exalted not only David, but it says to his descendants forevermore. Listen to me. David's example to us in this song cries out to us, each and every one of us, cries out for this. Make God your refuge. Make him your refuge in every trial, in every situation, in every hurt, in every pain, in every question, because he is a strong rock, and he is immovable. No enemy can overpower him. He's a strength before us. Take refuge in him. With unwavering hope, whatever's going on in your life, don't give up. Be secure in Jesus. Take your refuge in him. Hide in the rock, Christ Jesus. No confidence in the flesh. We as God's children can't live in the flesh and think that our flesh will accomplish anything. We need to trust in the Lord and surrender to him. Even after God rescues us, we should persevere, knowing that other enemies lurk in the shadows. There's another battle coming around the corner. There's another situation lurking its head at us. There's another thing that he's going to throw at us. And we need to trust him and live in him and take our refuge in Jesus. Father, I thank you for this time together with my brothers and sisters. I thank you for allowing David to write this psalm extolling your great power and your sufficiency and your honor, Lord, and how you take care of yours. Lord, we just want to be people who are walking with you, surrendering, realizing we cannot do it without you. Forgive us our sins, our failures, our weaknesses. Fill us with your strength, your power, your wisdom, because ours just doesn't work, Lord. So we surrender to you. Teach us this day and tomorrow, this weekend, whatever we do, help us to find our safety in you. If you call us to do something, let us walk out in strength, Lord, knowing that you will empower us to accomplish whatever you've called us to do. We thank you, Jesus. It's in your incredibly powerful, faithful, strong name, the name of Jesus, that we ask these things. Amen. Hey, have an incredible weekend, walking in victory, not in your own strength, but surrendering to Jesus, acknowledging his presence, and allowing him to bring the victory and use you in doing that. God bless you. See you Monday. Okay? All right. Bye-bye.